Okay, welcome. We're on part two, where I'm trying to convince you, and maybe you're slightly convinced now, that these trig formulas for addition and subtraction are pretty awesome. And here are the formulas we're talking about. Now, if you haven't done so yet, please take a moment and write out each of these formulas, and also look at the two sine formulas, the two cosine formulas, and the two tangent formulas, right? Look at them as pairs. And look for patterns, and then look between the groups of formulas, the pairings, and see if you notice any other patterns. So go ahead, pause the video, write these down, and start to hunt for the patterns that are there. Okay, we're going to discuss a couple of patterns, and I'm sure you might have found more, and I'm excited to hear what you have found. So for the two sine formulas, for addition and subtraction, just notice that for sine, when we're looking at addition, our terms are added on both sides, right? So here's a plus b are added, and then the sine cosine is added to the sine cosine over here. Also, when we're looking at the subtraction, we're subtracting on the right-hand side. However, with cosine, you might notice that the opposite happens. When we're looking at the addition of two angles or values, a and b, we subtract our terms, and when we're subtracting, we end up adding. That oppositeness is reserved for cosine, whereas sine has the same symbol or operator on both sides. Now, tangent kind of has a mix, right? Tangent behaves a little bit like sine in the sense that it has the same operator in the numerator, and it behaves a little bit like cosine in the denominator, and that makes a little bit of sense if you want to tie all these things together because, you know, math is fantastic. But remember that tangent is sine over cosine, right? So it makes a little bit of sense that the tangent for the addition of two values or the subtraction of two values will follow the same patterns as sine on top, where we have the same sign, and cosine on the bottom, where we have the opposite symbol, right? The opposite operator. So that sine-cosine connection to tangent is preserved, and you can see that same symbol pattern happening here. So adding for sine, adding in the numerator of tangent. Adding for cosine means we're subtracting, so we're subtracting in the denominator of tangent, right? So that's a nice little pattern to think about. Some other things you might notice but don't think are worth noting, I think they are, is that the sine is essentially, each term is composed of both sine and cosine. Sine, cosine. Sine, cosine, right? Whereas with cosine, we have double cosine and then double sine. So that's a little thing to notice as well. And there are other patterns to notice here, but I think those patterns essentially get us started, right? So tangent is made up of this fraction. Cosine and sine have two terms, right? One, two. And the sine swaps between sine and cosine. Cosine keeps it the same. Cosine, cosine, sine, sine, and so on and so forth. This allows us to realize that, okay, when we're thinking about these formulas, if we can think about and hold on to at least the first formula from each group, we can then derive the second. So if you know the sine of A plus B is sine A cosine B plus sine B cosine A, you know the sine of A minus B would be the same except for the operator in the middle. The same is true for cosine. If you know this first equation, you can then infer the second equation is the same except the symbols are opposite, which is also true in tangent. If you knew the first fraction here, you know that the tangent of A minus B is the same except the symbols are swapped. And that's true for all three cases. So really, a list of six formulas becomes a list of three formulas, and that's quite a relief. And, in my opinion, pretty awesome.